people that have got a bit of art, people that have got a bit of passion.
People who are from every walk of life come through our doors.
It's there to help very vulnerable people, people who have just not had a very good life.
Young people come to this building with lots of different problems, problems that are out of their control.
Homelessness, petty crimes, drugs, drink, it all goes together. And if we can get them down here and get them engaged, it might just break that cycle and it might help to change them.
It's a unique place. It gives you a good feeling when you see someone who's on a one-way street to nowhere and they manage to bounce back.
Once you get focus in life, everything becomes clearer.
The alcoholic who fights the devil every day. The drug addict who fights hell's cravings. The bullied who fight to survive the mental, physical and social abuse they dare not speak of. The abused child who fights to cling to a childhood that has long disappeared. The homeless who fight the cold, hunger and loneliness of the concrete doorway they now call home. Those who fight against prejudice and racism. The lady who fights for the courage to leave the punches that have become part of her life. The depressed who need friends to fight for them while needing love, support and understanding. It is time to realise that we are all fighters. Let's take a walk in Jack's shoes.
You can see there's good people wanting to come through.
I have seen a lot of people change down here. This is important because there's nothing else like this in the city.
Do you remember when I first came through the doors?
I do remember when you first came through the doors, yeah. You were terrible. You're the worst person I'd ever met in my life. You didn't want to do anything. You didn't want to train. You sat down all day. What was it you used to say? In what way, what was it you used to say?
Oh, it's legend. Won't dare.
Remember?
I'm Jade. A few years ago, after being excluded from mainstream school, I was referred down here to the Jack Raine Foundation. Coming here made me feel believed in. I have changed a lot as a person. I have more confidence and I even give up some of my time now to volunteer. When they asked me to get involved in making a film about the place that helped turn my life around, I jumped at the chance. I first came down when I was about 14. I wasn't very well behaved. No normal Main Street school would have me. I wasn't the only troublesome person in Vermoid, and there was loads. And we all used to just cause trouble, not listen.
People who, like yourself, who come in and don't really want to do anything and, you know, don't want to work, but over time and patience.
Couldn't do maths, that's where most of my problems came. And like last year I found out I've got dyslexia, but they didn't notice that.
What changes have I seen in you? You were the laziest person I ever met in my life when I first met you. And it didn't take very long, granted, for you to turn around. Look at you now, you're an independent young woman. You're out, you've got a job.
Even though it's 4 years and I don't have to help or support me, they're still always here for you. Here they're like, they highlighted everything you was good at and helped you excel in that, rather than making you do all the stuff you couldn't do. They're all different in their own way, they all approach you differently, but like deep down they all care about you, so they've all got that in common. I think when you're that age you need a role model, don't you? But if you don't feel believed in, you don't think you can do it, can you? My attitude's changed. Now I always thought like ambitions were dreams, like you'd never get them. But like they made me realise here that you can achieve them.
This is Russ. He's a trustee at the Jack Raine Foundation, a place inspired by one very special man and built on his values. It's more than just a boxing club, it's about a place at the heart of the community fighting for some of the most vulnerable people in society.
The Jack Raine Foundation, it's hard to describe because we offer so much. We're trying to get as much under one roof to offer to anybody of all ages, no matter what the background is. It's just open to everyone. We believe in giving everyone a second chance. I'll do 40, 50 hours a week. I do it for the love because this place does mean a lot to me. We're not just a boxing club. We open up in the morning, 6:30, 3 mornings a week to the Salvation Army. They bring 6 to 12 homeless down. Homelessness, petty crimes, drugs, drink, it all goes together. And if we can get them down here and get them engaged in some fitness, it might just break that cycle and it might help to change them, give them a sense of well-being, make them feel better about themselves in the area, stop committing crime. So it's having a knock-on effect, not just for us and them, but in the local area.
That's how it should feel, keep going.
At 9:30, we open as an alternative learning provision. We offer GCSEs, Duke of Edinburgh's, ASDAN. We're sort of known as a last chance saloon. They are the highest risk kids around York. We take them under our wing. We are the last chance for them.
It's all about you, it's about the effort you put in.
It works down here because the staff have been through the system, so the kids have respect for that.
I came through the education programme and it really changed my life. Let's meet some of the characters.
I love making a difference and it's nice to see them when they come through the doors for the first time and when they leave for the last time. There is a big, big difference in these people.
During my time down here, I've seen lots of people change. I mean, I'm speaking to somebody now that changed, you know, so there we go. There's one change from a few years ago, as you well know. Young people come to this building with lots of different problems that are out of their control. They might have some issue with anger, whatever, and this place is something that they can channel that anger and they go into society with a bigger and better outlook on life. But it works, it works, it works.
Some of them, they're not bad kids. 9 times out of 10, they're just misunderstood and a classroom environment doesn't suit them. We do more hands-on stuff and physical activity, physical exercise, shoulder to cry on, nurse, listening to them, and just being there for them when they need you.
I run the main day-to-day things with the kids in the gym. All the fitness work, all the cardio, keeping them under control, stopping them from turning out really bad. Young people, especially vulnerable young people, they're here to help out kids that haven't really got anywhere else to go.
I make sure every young person has a timetable and every young person that are working with so many different agencies, at the children's home, the police, social workers, youth offending team, they're very vulnerable.
Jack Raine Foundation helps lots of troubled young people, but does it really change their lives? Let's meet Kyle.
Kyle Bildsborough, seeing the change in that kid.
When I first met Kyle, I couldn't get two words out of him. He was always had his hood up, and we always have a laugh now about how he was like the Kevin and Perry character with his hood up, he can't be bothered to do certain things.
When I met him, he was going nowhere. Jail, that's where he was headed.
Well, it all changed, because like, after I come down for a few weeks, like, I realised that there weren't normal teachers, but it's real people. Try and bring out the best in you, not focus on your bad points, but all your good points. Try and bring them out, encourage you to do things.
The difference in him now is unbelievable. He's a totally different person, confident, special person, you know, to change his life around from what he was.
Oh man, you know, it's like winning the lottery. You know, from what he's doing now, he's a chef and he's got ambition and he's got a kid and he's going somewhere, you know what I'm saying? To see them getting on and doing well, oh, it's like winning the lottery, you know what I'm saying? It's the best feeling you can ever have. It's like a proper ultimate high.
Jack Raine Foundation have changed me as a person. Made me a better person. Well, now, because Jack Raine Foundation have helped me, I've got a job, which I've been doing nearly a year now. I've got a nice little girl, she's lovely. I've got my own flat. I don't think I've done it, like, if it didn't help me out, because I'd still be slapping on my own sofa and smoking weed, still just not making much of myself, really.
He was sort of going down a dead-end street, going nowhere, and then to turn his life around, all credit to him.
He's here 50, 60 hours a week. He's gone from being a very timid bloke to someone now that can think for himself. I'm proud of him and the whole team are glad to have him on board, so if he carries on the way he is, he'll be a star. He's got a very good future.
Once you get focus in life, everything becomes clearer.
In 2004, the charity was founded, but who was Jack Raine and why is the place named after him? I went with Russ to find out where the legacy began.
So, Jade, this is where it all started. That's the old schoolhouse where Jack and Inga used to work. We are what Jack used to do. This, as far as I know, used to be where the kids lived. These kids, they've done a lot of bad things, a lot of them. Jack used to discipline them through boxing. He used that as a way to draw out the inner them and try and steer them away from the bad things they've done. He earned a lot of respect by the way that he dealt with the kids. They looked up to him as a mentor. He got his message across. He was a very humble person. He didn't want to take any gratitude or anything for what he did. The boxing was used to mentally focus on, I suppose, to get some stability in the life. Jack and Inga played out the mum and dad role, and a lot of these kids didn't have role models or didn't have parents. Seeing the place, the building, it just fits all the pieces of the jigsaw together.
Jack Raine was a coach I met 25 years ago, and he was a boxing coach at the club where I used to box. When I stopped boxing, I wanted to get into coaching because of watching Jack. What I tried to do is keep values what Jack had and pass them on to people. Maybe not just in a boxing sense, but your values as a person.
Jack Raine, he just loved helping children who were just hadn't had a good life.
He was a good role model to look up to and to learn from.
Jack Raine's kindness has inspired so much of what the foundation does today. Russ went to meet Paul, a man who has been looked after by Jack.
I bumped into Lewis the other day, and he was telling me about Jack passing away. I didn't realise about that.
The end of last year, 3-4 days before his death, he actually agreed to have the charity named after him. How did you get to know Jack and Inga?
My first encounters with Jack and Inga, crumbs. 19th of October 1981, 2 p.m. I arrived at Castle Howard. My past life, it's always been in and out of care, 30 odd different kids' homes, 20 odd foster parents, and it's always been picked up and dumped all the time, and nobody in the country could take me anymore. So right. I ended up at the last place, which was, you know, Castle Howard. I mean, I was only 10 years old. I expected this big castle, like, you know what I mean, type thing, you know, with the name Castle Howard, you know. Typical life, you know, at that stage, you know, 1 minute I was up and next minute I was down from one place to another.
It was like a last chance for you, which is what we very much are with the kids that we work with today. If you don't mind me asking, what had you done? Why had you been pushed from pillar to post?
Basically, 18 months old, my mother dropped me off at this place called Linnea's House in Hull and ran away, basically, and left me there. So I was in care all my life from the age of 18 months onwards. I was just basically, you know, put from one care home, one foster home to another care home. A lot of the time, it was only short term. You just sort of like get used to the people, and then next minute you sort of like lose the bond and you lose that, you know, that faith in it. Every place I went to, it was always the same. Some places were really nasty. You got smacked and punished, cleaning on your hands and knees, stuff like that. And, you know, and it was just turned me into a vicious person. When I first went there and I went into the ICU unit, that's when I first met Inga. The person I was at that time, Inga told me to do something and I swore at her and ran away to the cells area where I was, hid underneath the bed. And I can always remember this because I was shocked, because it was the only person really ever to sort of like realise that instead of being harsh, she realised that it wasn't that I needed. That's when Jack and Inga basically built my life up for me, because I knew nothing about my life, you know. I mean, I was the same, 18 months old, in care. I never knew my mum, never knew my dad. I didn't even know I had brothers and sisters. I remember one summer, I think I was about 13, Jack, on his own back, went out and literally got all my files, and, you know, from all social services from around the country and everything. And I'll tell you what, I was amazed to see. I mean, you probably expect a little thing about that, but we're talking 4 to 5 folders, and they were about that thick each. And this was all about me, all the different kids' homes I was in and everything. And one summer, he actually sat down and he read all these to me. That's when I found out that I had a dad, my mum, I was a family of 9, but I was the only one that was put into care and not the others. And that really hurt me. You know, why me? It wasn't my fault the way I was. Jack and Inga would never give up. They gave more loving than, you know, harshness, you know what I mean?
They were definitely the positive role models in your life.
They actually found my parents. I couldn't bond with my parents for the simple reason is they abandoned me, where Jack and Inga, they basically found me. You know, I was like a lost puppy. And Jack and Inga found this poor lost puppy and took it under and left it underneath the wing.
If Jack and Inga hadn't come into your life, if you hadn't been introduced, sent to Castle Howard, where do you think you would be today?
Jail. Probably dead. I was an uncontrollable 10-year-old, 11-year-old, you know. All I ever knew was abuse. The only crime I committed was basically being born. Jack and Inga never failed on me. Never. They always gave for what I needed. They took me from a wild animal and tamed me in a way.
I can see how these people changed your lives, how Jack and Inga and the Reform Tree helped you.
He had a goal, and if his goal was to do something, he would go at it and go at it and go at it until that goal was complete. They knew of me having a really bad time in different places, the cruelty I was given, and they changed that cruelty into love and affection and understanding. It wasn't my fault, the way I was brought up. It was just the way society brought me up. I described Jack as a caring, understanding, lovable, you know, chap. I really strongly believe that, you know, if I had a choice of having a dad, I really would have picked Jack at that time, because I really would have believed that Jack and Inga would have, you know, sorted my life out really properly, and we became a family, you know. I can't really explain it anymore, you know, then, you know, if you had something that you love so much, that would be Jack. So understanding, never gave up, caring.
Jack and Inga's sort of legacy, what they were doing at Castle Howard, it carries on and in what we're doing today.
But if everybody sort of like followed what Jack was doing and understood people's problems.
We're open to anyone, come down and be part of what we are today.
I'd like to come and see the place, you know, and have nosy around with it.
It makes you realise what we're doing. It isn't until you do things like this and it brings it to the forefront of your mind that you do realise what a difference you're actually making.
I want to see what Jack's getting up to these days.
So Jack Raine is truly a foundation for the people. It's there for everybody, supporting the heart of the community.
My message would be, if anybody is thinking of sort of closing this place down, they would need to come down and have a look themselves, really, and just see all the positive things that are going on here.
We're not particularly bothered where they come from, who the mum and dad is, how much cash have they got, what trainers they wear, you know, it doesn't matter. They can just come down here and access the place and get off the street.
Kids who would end up stealing cars and out drinking, smoking, taking drugs at 6 o'clock on a night, stood on a street corner outside your house where you don't want them, are in this gym, you know, if nothing else. That's got to be worth a little bit of your time and money, hasn't it?
Well, there's been a couple of people that have been highlighted as being into criminal activity and they've been on police radar. Since coming down here, they're not even being to police attention.
Well, this place is inspiring. It brings a lot of good things out in a lot of people that probably wouldn't have had the chance.
This can change lives.
I think it's massive, mate, to be honest with you.
It's a brilliant resource for all members of the community. Everyone's so welcome here.
It's fantastic. It really is fantastic, and gives you a good feeling when you see someone who's on a one-way street to nowhere. And if Kyle can do it, you know, other people should look at themselves and think, well, I can do it and believe in themselves.
It's a lot more than a boxing club. Boxing club is only a tiny part of what we do. With the education, the work programmes we have, the boxing club's only like 10% of what we are now.
Since I've come down, I've come in probably 4-5 times a week. It's got me to a better standing up, that'll get me further into competition, so it's good it's not just a boxing club, because then you get different people coming down for different reasons and it helps other people in community and things like that.
The impact of getting just 8 or 9 lads that are drinking drugs, criminal activity, one is enough, but to get 8 or 9 down, the impact of them 8 and 9 going back to their other way of life, it would be a tremendous impact. And that's just that one session on the morning. It's not just us on the morning, it's continuing from 6:30 till 8:30, 9 o'clock at night.
We're helping them, give them aspirations and some meaning in life to move on and do something. We can only do it if we survive and keep going. We need your help to carry on doing that.
Without it, a lot of the kids would just get lost. Totally lost without this place.
York is one of those cities where everybody thinks everything's lovely. What people don't realise is that we have lots of problems in York. If this building no longer existed, if these people no longer existed, the crime rate would rise. That I guarantee you, okay? Because these kids wouldn't have anywhere to access, because they wouldn't be engaged with anybody. It's all about engaging with people.
The Jack Raine Community Foundation's here for everybody in the city. Whether you're underprivileged, you have an alcohol or drug problem, a young vulnerable person, people that are out of work, and some of the most severe cases of abuse in the city, right across the board.
Told me I should take caution when it comes to love, I did. And you were strong and I was not, my illusion, my mistake. I was careless, I forgot I did. And now, when all is done, there is nothing to say. You have gone up so effortlessly. You have won, you can go ahead, tell them all I know now. Shout it from the rooftops, write it on the
to all those people who don't know when I was 14, look at me now.
I don't want people to end up in prison. I don't want people to end up in young offenders institutions. Increase the quality of their lives.
It is an amazing place.